is my indoor voice on Charlie's Quarantine Corner. Happy Father's Day, and in the spirit of celebrating dads, here are some dad jokes. All right.
What's the best way to watch a fly fishing tournament? Live stream. I could tell you a joke about a pizza, but it's a little cheesy. I would not buy anything Velcro. It's a total ripoff.
Welcome to CQC News. 22-year-old Eddie Lin is a balloon artist who has started making elaborate sculptures to honor essential workers, such as nurses, doctors, and mail carriers, and his work has caught the attention of people all across the country. Eddie, who goes by the name Awesome Balloon Creator, was diagnosed with autism at the age of 3. By the time he was 10, he'd taught himself how to make very impressive balloon sculptures using YouTube tutorials. He has since turned that hobby into a lucrative business. He created his first essential worker sculpture to cheer up his friend's mother, who was stressed out as her role in a manager at a local grocery store. It was such a hit, he started creating more. Now his small business, the Awesome Balloon Creator, is flooded with paid requests to create similar appreciative gestures for heroes around the country. 9-year-old Cameron Johnson and some of her friends decided to make friendship bracelets and a lemonade stand as a way to raise money for people in need. She just told me she wanted to do it, so I helped promote it on social media, said her father, Ron. The promotion on social media gained traction and sales took off. Cameron has helped raise over $50,000 and was recently on Good Morning America. There is also a GoFundMe page, and that has raised close to $40,000. Cameron received some large donations from Minnesota Vikings players. Just as important as the money raised is the conversation that it has created. It seems like people want to listen and learn more than ever before, and Cameron has unknowingly helped catalyze that dialogue within her own neighborhood. Our neighborhood is like 95% white and maybe 5% minority, Ron said. We're the only black family within this little block. The fact that people that might not have known us or might not have felt right to approach us are stopping by to talk and ask questions, it's a good thing. That's really important right now. Now, the key is pushing the conversation forward. As much as people are willing to talk about racism and injustice during this moment in time, Ron said, it doesn't mean those issues are going to magically go away. There needs to be a continued focus on change. We have to find a way to continue to talk about these things, Ron said. I hope people will understand that. Native Americans who live in the Navajo Nation along the remote borders of Utah, Arizona, and New Mexico often have a lack of running water, limited internet access, and now soaring cases of COVID-19. Jennifer Francis, founder of the traveling Best the Book Bus Literacy nonprofit, saw a video on Facebook recently featuring a third grade teacher in Utah traveling long distances to deliver food and learning packets to children. Francis, who lives in Tampa, Florida, has driven a bus to the Navajo Nation several times, delivering books to kids at more than a dozen schools across the reservation. Francis arranged to mail a pallet of 1,500 new picture books and juvenile fiction and nonfiction titles for kids in kindergarten through sixth grade at Montezuma Creek Elementary, so the books could be distributed to all 310 students in the district. Charlene Poyer, a teacher and member of the Navajo Nation, lives about 30 miles from the school. She says about 40% of her students are unable to continue their studies via Zoom classes as they do not have internet access. The gift of books from Mrs. Francis came at just the right time, she said, to add some excitement to her students' daily routine and provide a little relief from the usual math, spelling, and vocabulary packets. In this area where we live, we have one trading post, one store, and one post office, a school, and a health clinic. Poyer said, there is no place to buy a book. So the surprise of receiving these books is the best thing that could have happened for our children right now. Thousands of demonstrators took to the streets in Philadelphia Saturday to protest the death of George Floyd, but two stood out in the crowd, a bride and groom. Carrie Ann and Michael Gordon, wearing their full wedding attire, joined protesters at City Hall after their ceremony. It ended up being a very powerful moment, said Carrie Ann Gordon. Not only are we feeling the movement of the people, but I'm joining my husband on our wedding day. It was a very, very empowering moment for us, considering all that is happening. They both felt it on a personal level. Seeing multiple races at the protests made this day more memorable. We all see this injustice. We all want to see this needle shift away from the status quo, Michael Gordon said. Congratulations to the happy couple. Like many people right now, Corey Capilone misses his grandmother. Capilone lives in Northwest DC and his grandmother lives in Scranton, Pennsylvania in an assisted living facility. So it's hard to make a routine trip. But he has tried to keep her spirits up with lots of phone calls, sending her treats and scrapbooks. And now he's about to begin a run to see her, literally, running from DC to Scranton. Capilone is going to run the 220 miles over the next weeks along trails that run from DC to Scranton. Along with his desire to see his grandmother, he's hoping it'll at least spur others to act. Capilone said, reach out to an assisted living home or nursing home in your community to see what you can do. He suggested writing letters to folks that may otherwise be lonely. He's already raised thousands of dollars for his grandmother's living facility. And that'll do it for CQC News. Thank you so much for joining us, and we'll get you back to your regularly scheduled program. What's that? No one's in here? Is the pandemic still happening? Why are people at the beach? I don't understand. What is it? There's no vaccine yet, so I'm still here alone. All right.
I don't play soccer because I enjoy the sport. I do it for the kicks. Why are elevator jokes so classic and good? They work on so many levels. What do you call a fake noodle? An imposter.
Next on Charlie's Quarantine Corner, Charlie puts the spotlight on someone she loves in this week's InterZoom. Get it? Like an interview, but over Zoom? Sort of a play on words. You know, forget it. Just bring on State Rep Gouveia.
I saw that you've been hiking while doing Zoom calls and working, and I love that because I'm a mom and I'm trying to make this very professional show at the same time that I'm homeschooling. So I thought that was just so creative. I don't think I could do the Zoom call because my kids are young, but how did you come up with that idea? And are there any trails that you really liked?
Yeah, so Acton has like 18 different conservation areas. And once you hike them all, you get a sticker. And so my partner and I have been, we have two left, two very short trails left. So we've done pretty much all of them in the town of Acton. And I'll be honest, you know, in the beginning with COVID, I was working 12, 14, 16 hour days, trying to respond to the crisis, helping constituents get access to unemployment, answer questions, you know, try to create a container and a space where people could feel supported and safe. And that was really stressful for me. And as a public health social worker, I know how important self-care is. And I also know that modeling behavior that I think we all should be trying to adhere to is also really important. So I decided to take my Zoom calls to the hiking trails, and there were some days I was out there for 2.5 hours, and it was it's a really positive way for me to decompress and enjoy nature. And now that, you know, we're in the springtime, just seeing how lush everything is really encouraging and making me feel even that much more grounded, and just that I know that I'm taking care of my own well-being. And spending time with dogs and my partner out in the woods is a really great way to sort of escape and get out there when we can't get out in other ways that we're used to.
You are the model, like, Massachusettsian. I don't know, Massachusetts person. I'm pretty sure within 24 hours of seeing you post that, I took my kids on a hike and I was just like, I need to just do this. And you're showing how people can, like, just cope with this. And are you a healthcare provider?
Yeah, so I have a master's in social work and a master's in public health, and I'm working on my doctorate in public health focused on opioid policies. And so just having that 20-year experience in the public health space, have really been using my professional background as it relates to this pandemic that we're in the middle of, and really trying to find ways to connect to my constituents and things that they're struggling with, and just, you know, how incredibly difficult this can be. But this also creates a lot of opportunities for us to, you know, I'm hearing of people who have finally gotten to know their neighbors a little bit, but keeping their distance, but, you know, getting to know their neighbors and appreciating things in their community that they're not normally able to appreciate, you know, people sharing resources, sharing masks, delivering masks and food, and, you know, all the outreach. I think those are the ways that we demonstrate our community spirit and our love for our neighbors, which we're not always so great about doing as a society. And so I think there's a lot of good that is also coming out of this challenging time that we're in.
Is there anything specific that you're working on that you want to tell Mass residents about?
Yeah, there's a couple things. And I really appreciate that you're doing this show this way and that you're highlighting the good. I think, you know, so often media and journalism is focused on the problems. And there's a whole host of new journalists that are coming up that are focused on solutions journalism. And I would put this squarely in that space of, like, let's focus on the things that are going well and going good. And there's a lot of, you know, really great thinkers around this. The things that I've been working on. So I was one of the early people who reached out to the governor in early March and said, hey, we got to start shutting this state down. And I know what the ramifications are of that. You know, it means that people might be in a house that they're with family members that are not the safest place for them to be. Or for a lot of our students, they wouldn't have access to nutritious food during the day, or that people wouldn't be getting a paycheck. And so I didn't just say, hey, let's shut down and walk away from the problem. I said, okay, let's shut down and let's find ways to make sure that we're getting resources to people who really need it. And so I filed legislation to get cash assistance into the hands of working families, $1,000 per person within certain income categories, plus an additional $500 for dependents. That's really important for Massachusetts, even though the feds have taken some steps in this direction. Massachusetts is a very expensive state to live in. And the federal guidelines also left out a lot of our working families that I think is really important for us to make sure that we're also taking care of. So I filed that legislation, testified in support of it, also filed some other legislation to make sure that if people who are our frontline essential workers get sick, that and they get sick with COVID, that their illness is presumed to be work-related, and they don't need to use their own personal sick or vacation time if they have to quarantine or take time off so that they can, you know, heal and get better.
And that's true right now for all Mass residents? That's true?
That's legislation I filed for all essential workers. Yeah, okay. So that's making its way through the process. You know, just recognizing that there are essential workers who don't have enough earned sick time and they're having to pay out of pocket. Like, they're out there working every single day in support of all of us, you know, our grocery store clerks and our gas station attendants and our nurses. You know, they're left out of federal legislation. So I wanted to make sure that they were supported by us as well. And so that's another piece of legislation I filed. Been working with a lot of colleagues, just trying to push the governor to really prioritize health and public health over the, you know, opening the economy too quickly. I think soon we'll hear an announcement about restaurants. I know there's been a lot of questions around restaurants. I think it's a little premature, some of the actions that we've been taking, but I think we'll see. And I'm keeping my fingers crossed that we can all, you know, get out there soon and be back in community. I miss people. I miss being in person with people desperately. And I'm sure there are a lot of people who miss that as well and miss being able to play basketball with their friends or, you know, hug their grandchildren. The third thing I did was working to make sure that we can access the ballot in September and November and do it safely if people choose to vote in person. I fully support vote by mail efforts. There is legislation pending on that, but I also filed legislation to extend the hours of voting for weekend voting, for evening voting, and then making sure that cities and towns are planning to protect their poll workers and voters who show up to the polls in September and November so that people can do that safely, that people have enough PPEs, that there's physical distancing, and that might require that some pole locations get moved or get redesigned to make sure that we're protecting everybody. And so that was the other piece of legislation that I'm championing right now.
Can you just like be president or something? Like everything you have just said is like all of the things I care about. Do you have anything else?
Well, how are your kids and how is your family and how are you keeping sane? I mean, you're going out on hikes and homeschooling and all of this like real big shift. How are you doing?
Well, we are one of the families that you're fighting for. So that's kind of why you're on my radar. We are a low income family. My husband is a veteran. So it's been really hard. It's been actually really, really difficult. And homeschooling feels almost impossible with a kindergartner and a preschooler. And now we're gearing up to put them in first and kindergarten. And the homeschool is fun. Like, I feel like other moms and dads get like irritated when I say that, because it's just like, how is it fun? But I also don't do it that often, because it's more about like them being comfortable right now and not feeling, you know, my kids are young enough that they're kind of like, yeah, okay, when the virus is gone, then we can go to the park. Like, they're kind of oblivious. But it's been really encouraging the different things that people are doing. Like I live in Chelmsford. We're going to the Chelmsford High School every day and getting meals for our whole family and just seeing people every day that like know who I am now. And they're like, family of four, come on up. And I haven't had to go to the grocery store pretty much at all in the last over a month because of that. So it's really, you know, struggle is struggle, but it's a really good time to see the bright side of life, so to speak.
Yeah, that's amazing. Well, thank you. And thank you for sharing your experience. And it helps me to understand a little bit more about your family and what you're contending with. And thank you to your husband for his service as well. No, we couldn't do Memorial Day. Don't know if we'll be able to do Veterans Day in any way, shape, or form. But, you know, thank you to him and to your family.
So at some point, I would love to have you back on the show. We were supposed to do roller derby, which was going to be so cool. My homegirl, Amber, was going to hook that up. So we have to do that, like, as soon as everything opens up. Maybe that's, like, phase 8, you know.
Yeah, I think so.
Thank you so much for being here, and I really appreciate you working so hard for my community and my family.
Why did the Scarecrow win an award? Because he was outstanding in his field. I made a pencil with 2 erasers. It was pointless. How do you make a tissue dance? Put a little boogie in it. Thank you, thank you.
And now, a special musical performance from CQC resident artist, Naked Frankie, the Fabric Performer.
I love myself, I want you to love me. When I feel down, I want you above me. I search myself, I want you to find me. I forget myself, I want you to remind me. I don't want anybody else. When I think about you, I touch myself. Oh, I don't want anybody else. No, oh no, oh no, oh.
You're the one who makes me come running.
You're the sun who makes me shine.
When you're around, I'm always laughing.
I want you to make me mine. I want you to make mine. I close my eyes and see you before me. You think I would die if you were to ignore me? A fool should see just how much I adore you. I get on my knees and I'll do anything for you.
Oh, I don't want anybody else.
Oh no, oh no, oh no,
oh yeah. Oh, I don't want anybody else. And when I think about you, I touch myself. Oh, I don't want
anybody else. Oh no,
oh no, oh no, yeah, I want.
everybody else. And when I think about you, I touch myself. It feels really good. And I don't want anybody else. And when I think about you, I touch myself. Oh, I don't want anybody else. When I think about you, I touch myself. I want to see so many names right now, but I think I'll get in trouble. I touch myself. I touch the shit out of it. I flick the bean.
I used to hate facial hair, but, you know, then it grew on me. You know, people say they pick their nose, but I was born with mine. Why can't you hear a psychiatrist using the bathroom? Because the pee is silent. I ordered a chicken and an egg online. I'll let you know. How do you get a squirrel to like you? Act like a nut! All right, that'll do it. Thank you, thank you. Thank you very much.